Hey, good morning and welcome to Harvest Christian Center. My name is Pastor Daniel. I'm the youth pastor here, and I'm just so glad you're here with us. at church today. Why don't you take a second and invite somebody to join us online today by sending them the link hcclpaso.com/live. And as a church, we want to be praying for you. So if you have prayer requests, you can submit those at hcclpaso.com/prayer. I don't know about you, but I'm expecting God to do great things in our service today. So why don't you stand to your feet with me this morning and let's get ready to worship Him.
God Almighty, I hope you'll find me praising your name no matter what comes, because I know where I'd be without your mercy. So I keep praising your name at the top of my lungs.
I can't count the times I've called your name some broken night. Showed up and patched me up like you do every time. I get amnesia. I forget that you keep coming around. Yeah, there ain't no way you ever let me down.
Good God Almighty, I hope you'll find me praising your name no matter what comes, 'cause I know where
hardships of life without God. You know, I just don't know how they make it. I've been missing my dad a lot lately. And I know we all are. We're all grieving this year after Pastor Lee passed away unexpectedly, so suddenly, and we're just figuring out all the things and the things we have to do. And normally I am a really high capacity person, and I just do it. And I've had a hard time. I've been telling Robert a lot lately, like, I just don't have, it's not the same right now. It's because the heaviness is on me. It just is, it just is. We have to go through the grief, and it just is. But one thing that I can do is the things I know to do. So I just talk to the Lord. I just tell him, and I praise him. I praise him. I thank him for the house that he put me in. I do the things I love to do, like my garden, and that's very therapeutic too, but I'm out there and all of his creation. So it helps. It helps do that. But how we, and I can get up here and I can worship with you because God is good. God is good. Life is hard, but God is always good. He's always good. And before we sing this next song, I want us to read Psalm 148 together. It just says it. It starts right off. Praise the Lord. Mm-hmm. And that is hallelujah. That means you praise Yahweh. You praise the Lord. That's what praise the Lord means. Hallelujah. It means you praise the Lord. So here the psalmist writes, you praise the Lord. And then he says, praise the Lord from the heavens. Praise him in the heights above. Praise him, all his angels. Praise him, all his heavenly hosts. Oh, and Pastor Lee's up there doing that. Praise him, sun and moon. Praise him, all you shining stars. Praise him, you highest heavens and you waters above the skies. The skies have been praising the earth, right? Watering down from heaven this week. Let them praise the name of the Lord, for at his command they were created, and he established them forever and ever. This ancient text writes about God's creation. It's beautiful. He issued a decree that will never pass away. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord from the earth, you great sea creatures and all you ocean depths, lightning and hail, snow and clouds, stormy winds that do his bidding, you mountains and all hills, fruit trees and all cedars, wild animals and all cattle, small creatures, mosquitoes too, I guess, and flying birds, kings of the earth and all nations, you princes and all rulers of the earth, young men and women, old men and children. That's all of us, right? We're going to praise the Lord. Let them praise the name of the Lord, for his name alone is exalted. Hallelujah. His splendor is above the earth and the heavens. Let's say that again. His name alone is exalted. For his name alone is exalted. His splendor is above the earth and the heavens. And he has raised up for his people a horn. Right there, that means like a strength. The praise of all his faithful servants of Israel. We're now part of Israel. We've been grafted in. The people close to his heart. So we're close to his heart. You people close to his heart. Praise the Lord. Amen. Let's do it. every eye will see, and every knee will bow. All the glory and power to Christ our King. He reigns forever, all creation sings. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him on the earth below. He is worthy, worthy. Praise God, all you heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. He is worthy, worthy. Praise God. Praise God. He is worthy, worthy. Praise God. Inside, we might feel heavy and heavy-hearted. We can still praise the Lord because He's still good. Yes, He is. And those are the habits that I do, that I put in place. You know, it's just to praise Him. And He's a good God. Yes, He is. And He knows what He's doing. And He turns things and makes it for good when we surrender everything to Him. And you know, when I say I miss my dad and it's hard and all that, believe me, I'm so proud of Robert, my son, and how he's just surrendered to God. And I'm just watching this, and it's a wonderful thing. God is using him. So God, He's taking care of us. This church is His, right? And He's taking care of us as we go step by step forward in each day. This is the time when the altars are always open. What is an altar? Well, it's here in the front. And sometimes we can make our seat an altar, though. But it's the place where we meet God. It's also a place where we remember what God has done for us already. It's a place where we meet God. If you need something, our prayer team, pastoral team will be down here. They'll come down here and meet you here to pray with you. Maybe you just want to come to the altar by yourself and just meet God. It's a place of surrender, acknowledging who God is. So our altars are always open, but especially now, I want to make sure you know that they're open for you to step down here if you need to as we continue worship.
Every time I come running, find grace on me. You welcome me with open arms, no matter where I Every time I surrender, every time I fall, I find grace more precious than I did before. So I'm gonna lay my world here at your feet. Look to the heavens for all I need. I'm gonna sing my upon grace. Morning, my morning, day after day will I see. Grace upon grace, God be exalted over and over again.
Back to life.
can I begin to thank you for all that you've done for me? Jesus, to fully praise you, it will take all eternity, just like Lazarus. Oh, you brought me back.
Yes, you will be. You are. There's no one like you. Thank you, Jesus. We worship you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
You gave your life for mine. Nailed to the cross, you crucified all my sin and shame. Was washed by your mercy. You are the treasure I find, my reason for living. So let my life become an offering to the one who is worthy. All praise to the Lord Most High. All praise to the one who saved my life. All praise.
Just like Lazarus, God, we've died, God, to our sin, knowing that you, Lord, give us life, not just eternal life, but life here in the moment, God, here in this world, Lord, you speak life, you speak fulfillment, you speak joy, peace into our lives now, God. Lord, we just ask right now that you would meet us here, God, that for those in pain, in hardship, in suffering, whatever it is in their life, God, that you would meet them here. God, that you would show them that you are the God who sees and knows and is with us, God, every day. Lord, come and move in this place. Let our hearts be open to you, God. Let our hearts be receptive to you, Jesus. God, and we invite you right now into this moment, into this service, God. We thank you, Lord, for who you are and all that you do, God. In your name. Amen. Amen. God is good, isn't he? Yes, he is. Well, good morning, everyone. My name is Pastor Hannah. We're so happy to have you here today. And if you're new with us, we just want to say a special welcome to you. We hope you just feel loved and accepted today. And if you haven't yet, go ahead and fill out the Get Connected card that's in front of you in the seat back in front of you. This is just a way for us to get to know you a little bit more and have a name to your face. And we're going to take the next quick 30 seconds or so and do a quick meet and greet. So if you want to turn to the person next to you or find someone you don't know and say hi to them. And if you're watching online, we just want to say hello, welcome. We're so happy you're joining us this morning. If you want to go ahead and take a seat, which you already, most of you already have, we're going to go ahead and watch these announcements.
Good morning and welcome to church. If you're our guest today, we're so glad you've joined us. Would you let us know? There's one of two ways you can do that. You can text Harvest EP to 94,000. You'll get a menu of options there. You'll fill out option one. or there's a Get Connected card in the seat back in front of you. Fill that out. And then whatever you do, make sure you stop by our Welcome Center. Bring that Get Connected card with you to the Welcome Center, where our greeter there would like to get better acquainted with you, answer any questions you might have, and give you a packet of information. Again, we're glad you've joined us for church today. Wednesdays are an important day at Harvest Christian Center. Wednesdays at noon, we have a prayer meeting right here in the main auditorium. And then Wednesday evenings at 6:30, we gather the whole family. We have Oasis Kids, we have our youth ministry, we have classes upstairs, and we have service in the main auditorium. So a place for every one of you. Make sure you join us on Wednesday. Maybe you haven't heard yet, but we do have an HCC music school teaching piano and guitar, and we are opening up the schedule again for September. So we'll have some open slots available for September. You can go to hccelpaso.com. Right there on the front page, you'll hit events and classes, and you can click the link there and get more information. Or you can email Noah Moran, and his email is here on the screen. But again, that's piano or guitar. You can sign up for September. Harvest Christian Center Medical Clinic will reopen on Saturday, August 27th. Yes, we have a free medical clinic. This is run by our very own Dr. Barbara Reeves. So we'll reopen on August 27th, and then in September, it's September 10th and 17th. And then the months after that, beginning in October, it will be the second and fourth Saturday of every month. Again, this is a free medical clinic, but you must be here at 9 a.m. every Saturday if you need medical attention. Men, we do want to remind you of the conference coming up for you. Friday, August 26th and Saturday, August 27th down at Grace Christian Center. This will be Friday night at 7 o'clock. It'll be dinner and a rally. Saturday morning at 9 a.m. until noon. You'll hear from our own Pastor Robert that Saturday morning. We do need a head count. So if you'll stop by the Welcome Center and sign up, if you do plan on attending, you'll get acquainted with other Christian men from other churches here in our city. So make plans to attend. And we do want to highlight this most recent edition of our Worldview magazine at our missions kiosk, highlighting Ukraine. And just flipping through this and seeing the photos, it just tugs on your heart at what these people have been going through. But you can stop by and pick one up, read all about what God is doing through our missionaries on the ground there.
Hey, I have a question for you. Are you in a small group? And if not, why? Small groups are the best way for you to get connected to our church. If you want to make friends, if you want to grow in your relationship with God, and if you want to be more connected other than just a Sunday morning, small groups are the best way to do that. We offer a variety of groups, whether you're a mom, a dad, whether you're married or a young person, whatever season of life you're in, we have a group for you. The last 2 weeks of August, we'll have some tables out in the lobby where you can come meet and greet with the leaders and find out what groups we have. So if you're interested in a small group, be on the lookout for that. We have a special guest with us today, one of our very own missionaries, Tanae Miller, who is a missionary to the Arctic, and we've supported her for a very long time, so she is just one of those awesome people, and we get to hear from her this morning what God has been doing in her ministry, and what God is just how he's been using her. So let's give her a warm welcome as she comes up.
Praise the Lord. Good morning. Hallelujah. This is the day that the Lord has made and we'll rejoice and be glad in it. Amen. Hallelujah. So my name is Tanae Miller and I work in the Arctic of Canada to the Inuit Eskimo, literally in the Arctic Circle where the average temperature is 60 degrees below zero. It is cold. It's really, really cold. But I work with seven churches in the Arctic, and I'm an associate pastor, and I work with the pastors that are up there. I also evangelize the other villages. We're hoping to do some church plants up there. And we are believing God for a mighty outpouring of his spirit among the Inuit people. Amen. Hallelujah. I want to read a scripture very quickly. It's in Isaiah 60. I'm sure many of you are familiar with it. It says, "Arise, shine, for thy light is come, and the glory of the Lord is risen upon you. For behold, the darkness shall cover the earth, and gross darkness the peoples, but the Lord shall arise upon you." Hallelujah. "And his glory shall be seen upon you, and the Gentiles shall come to your light, and kings to the brightness promise of your rising. Hallelujah. You know, several months ago, I woke up and the Lord spoke to me a word and he said, ignite. And I saw in the spirit the hand of the Lord, and he had a match in his hand, and he was ready to strike that match. And it began to fire up. And the Lord spoke very clearly that he is about to ignite his people with the fresh fire of his spirit. Amen. I believe that God is going to pour out his glory in this region. Amen. In El Paso, in Ciudad Juarez. And you know, there's some gross darkness that's trying to come. The enemy is trying to bring darkness and fear. But we know that the fire and the igniting of his spirit is about to come in this area for the glory of the Lord and in the uttermost parts of the earth with the Inuit. Amen. I appreciate your prayers, and I'm so thankful for all of you, for your prayers for the nations, your heart for missions. Thank you for your giving and your support for what you've done for me. But I believe that this word is for you today. Amen. That he is about to ignite his people. Amen. And the light of Jesus and the love of Jesus is going to shine through you, and people are going to come to the love of Jesus in you. Amen? Amen. Amen. Thank you for your prayers, and God bless you. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord.
It's good to see you again, Tanae. And we love Tanae, yes. And certainly I love Tanae, and it's just an honor to have you here today. And,
thank you.
And can we all pray for her real quick? Dear Lord, we thank you for Tanae, and as she's getting ready to go minister in the Arctic with the Inuit people, I just pray that you will bless her and allow her to be a blessing to those that she's ministering to and yes. serving. And I pray through her, through when the gospel is being preached and through her ministry, that there will be a number of people who come to Christ. And we're praying for miracles will go before her, and just that, Lord, you will make yourself known in these areas in the Arctic Circle. And Lord, we just pray your blessings upon her life, blessings upon her mom, blessings upon just everything she does. Open doors, give her favor wherever she goes, all of it, Lord. We thank you for Tanae, and in Jesus' wonderful name, amen.
Amen. Thank you. I forgot to mention, I leave in 2 weeks.
2 weeks.
2 weeks.
Okay. God bless you. Well, church is good. Yeah, we can give her a round of applause one more time. It's good to see you, church. If you are new here today, and I haven't had the opportunity to meet you, my name is Pastor Robert, and I'd love to, after second service, after the service is over, if you're willing and have the time just to come down here to the altar, just to shake your hand, say thank you for being here today. I often am not able to get out to the lobby, but you don't have to. I just like to meet you. But as we're getting ready for today's tithes and offerings, I'd like to encourage you, since Tanae has been with us today, we want to bless her. And so if you have a special offering for her, cash, check, you can do it online through the app or through the website. Just make sure you mark it special, and we will know that's for Tanae. And as she's getting ready 2 weeks to go to the Arctic Circle with the Inuit, just as she's going out, help to take care of her in that process. Again, if you would like to just be a blessing to her, mark it special. We'll make sure it gets to Tanae. And hey, this is a generous church. We are a faithful church in our offerings and our tithe, that 10% to the Lord. And so I just want to encourage you to continue to walk in that faithfulness to God. And, you know, of course, God shows up in really, like, incredible ways sometimes. But sometimes it's just the mundane aspects of life where God shows up. And honestly, those are the more consistent aspects of life, aren't they? And it's just good to know that when we're faithful to the Lord, not just in our finances, but faithful to God in everything, he's faithful to us. Hallelujah. Life isn't perfect. That's not what that says. But at least he's faithful in the messiness of life. And that's what we really want. And so, of course, you see the different ways that you can give. You can give. If you get an envelope, you can put it in the black boxes between each one of those double doors. You can text to give. You can use the Church Center app. And you can give online. But let's pray for today's offering. Dear Lord, we thank you for the opportunity we have just to thank you and to praise you through our giving and our finances. And help us to realize that we don't own what's ours. We don't own what's in the bank account. We don't own our homes. No, rather, we are stewarding those things on your behalf. You own all things. It's all yours, God, and we're managing these things. So help us to manage them well. Help us to manage our finances, our material goods, our time in such a way that it honors you and is a blessing to those around us. And Lord, as we are faithful to you, we just pray that your continued faithfulness upon our lives. And in Jesus' wonderful name, all of God's people say, amen. Amen. Hey, you know what? As people, especially in first service, I didn't do the second service because, of course, I was out here. But in first service, as people are coming in, I'm kind of, my office is on the second floor, so I can see people as they're coming in. It's a good thing and a bad thing all at the same time. No, not really. But it's just, it's such an honor to be able to be a part of this church with you. I really, it's like no one has to be here, but we all want to be here because of Jesus. You know what I mean? And we care about each other. This is a church who does care about each other. And I just want to encourage you in that and just say, man, it is such a privilege to be your pastor and to come alongside you and just be a part of this church. And you're amazing people. I want you to know that. You are all incredible, and let's keep being incredible together. What do you say? And then maybe as you are coming in, did anyone notice the rock and that it's engraved? If you maybe as you leave today, you'll see that rock. In the next couple weeks, I just want to make mention of it. Next couple weeks, we'll kind of talk about what does Ebenezer mean, kind of expand all that. But it's really cool. It's in honor of Pastor Lee and, of course, my grandma, which Pastor Lee was my grandpa, but Pastor Lee and Linda, which I don't say too often, that's for sure. But before we get into today's message, one last announcement is right after second service, we have our Harvest DNA class. So if you want to get more involved at Harvest, you want to know about the history of Harvest, the culture of Harvest, to get plugged into plugged into a small group, all those different things, that class is for you. It's all about how to become a part of Harvest Christian Center. And that'll be right after second service, a two-week class. So this Sunday and next Sunday in the multi-purpose room, which is a big room right off kind of this way. There are snacks, and we will do everything we can to keep it at an hour. So if you want to become a part of Harvest, make sure to stop by, be a part of that class. My wife, Hannah, who was up here a little bit before me, and myself will make sure to teach that class. But on that note, if you're new today, we've been in a long series going through 1 Corinthians all summer long. So if you have your Bible, you can open it up to 1 Corinthians chapter 11. Now, we've been dealing with chapter 11. We started this last week dealing with three abuses. So there was the wonderful topic that we talked about last week, the abuse of head coverings. And then this week we're going to talk about communion, the abuse of communion, how the church was abusing communion. And then one of the specific gifts of the Spirit, which is the gift of speaking in tongues or speaking in another language, and how the church was abusing that. And we want to keep in mind that these three abuses were specifically when the church would gather and interact with each other, they were abusing each other and abusing these gifts really for their own selfish aim. It became more about themselves and not about Jesus or not about the body. And so I want to read this to you and see if you kind of agree with me. Because of humans' sinful tendency, we have a tendency to one-up each other. Anyone know that's true? Just out there in the world, kind of, if you can measure up and you're a little better, well, then you're a little better, and for whatever reason, we kind of do that stuff by nature, right? And we can show it in all kinds of ways. There's the subtle name dropper. Anyone know that person? And it's like, okay, yeah, so you know all those people. Yeah, sure, whatever. Or you have the know-it-all. It's like they always know a little more than you do. You've got the designer brands person, always has to have a designer brand and just show how amazing they are because they've got all the brands. Even body language, simply the way we look at people, the way we smile at people, we kind of know those things by nature. Then we have even more like obvious ways, the boasting. Hopefully we all understand this, the peacocker. The person who's constantly they flaunt it and they let everyone know it, I'm the best, look at me. And then you got like a group of five men and they're all like peacocking with each other, who's going to be the best one? And you guys know what I'm talking about, right? Hopefully we all understand that. And it's this sinful tendency. What is this sinful tendency in us that makes us want to one-up each other? I think it boils down to pride. It's pride that wants to judge someone else and say, I'm a little better than them. And if we can devalue them, while at the same time enhance our value, somehow then we're better than them. And then if we can kind of do it in subtle ways, it helps us get the raise, right? Or at least we can pretend like we have a better life. Or at least we'll get the praise from our boss or our coworkers or whatever it may be, and just kind of feel good about ourselves. And if we don't watch it as the church, as Christians, followers of Jesus, we bring the same prideful mentality into the church. And we're going to kind of coin it this way, spiritual superiority. Somehow, and that's exactly what the church at Corinth is doing. They're abusing communion, a spiritual gift that God has given us, or they're abusing the gifts of the Spirit, specifically speaking in tongues, to make it seem like they're superior to other people in the church. Have you ever been around a Christian? Maybe you don't need to raise your hand. Have you ever been around someone like that? Who just kind of makes it seem like they're better than you as a Christian? Yep. Somehow. That's not a cool thing. So then you have these two abuses, communion and speaking in tongues, and they're ultimately, this is all kind of rooted in pride. But that's not the way Jesus would want us to live, is it? Can we agree on that? That is absolutely anti-Jesus. In fact, Jesus denied himself for us. Jesus, the King, God himself, he said no to his identity, his rightful identity, and he took on the identity of a sinner and a criminal for you and me. Isn't that mind-blowing to think about? Completely denied himself. As it says in Philippians, he became nothing so that we may be saved. See, Jesus, he loves us. He loves us so much he was willing to give his life for us, and he's genuinely concerned about our well-being. It's not concern in the sense of he's anxious or worried. It's genuine care. I want the best for them. I want a healthy relationship. I want them to know I love them. I want them to walk in everything I have for them. Now, to kind of break it down this way, on Friday, that's Hannah and I's day off, we went for a hike. We went up onto the Tom Hayes. There's a trail called the Schaefer Loop, and it's a 3.5-mile trail. So I had Soren. If we got an 11-month-old, 25-pound baby, basically, strapped to my chest. And after 3.5 miles hiking, it gets pretty tiring, that's for sure. And we thought we were going to have good cloud cover the entire trail. We looked up the weather. Didn't look like there were going to be any issues. Halfway through the hike, the clouds kind of disappeared. And we didn't prepare for sun, and we didn't prepare him for sun, so he didn't have a hat, he didn't have sunscreen, his arms were uncovered, his feet were uncovered. And so we were thinking, what are we going to do? Well, what do you do? I took off my shirt, and I put my shirt on him, and then he had a little hood, so he had a hood, and his hands are covered, his everything, but my back's pretty red. You know what I mean? But what dad wouldn't do that? What parent wouldn't do that for their child? And that's kind of the mentality I'm talking about here. That's how we should be as Christians. We have love and concern for others that we'll deny ourselves to take care of them. Amen. I mean, it ties into what we talked about last week, the selfishness. It's about healthy and honoring relationships. We don't want to shame anyone. We want to have healthy relationships. And oftentimes, our selfishness can cause shame on someone else. And so we don't want that, and we certainly don't want to be prideful. And we're going to kind of focus more on the pride issue today. But then one other thing before we get into the passage. Have you ever noticed that the most spiritual people around are oftentimes the most down-to-earth, loving, and genuine? Have you ever noticed that? Like, look at Pastor Lee, for those of you who knew him. He was deeply spiritual, wasn't he? He was with God. He prayed with God constantly. That's just who he was. But he never tried to flaunt it. He never tried to act spiritual. He never tried to, when he was interacting with you relationally, he loved you. He was genuine with you. He was down to earth with you. That's just who he was. That is true spirituality. Not this, hyper-spiritual, fluffy language, I seem spiritual, I've got a word for everyone under the sun type mentality, which words are a real thing, a prophetic word or some, those things are real, but when we go around just kind of flaunting it all the time, it's like, well, hold on a second. We can pull off that a little bit, right? We can just be in a genuine relationship here and care about each other. That's what Paul is ultimately, as we go through these two abuses, Paul's trying to get at. Just, it's not about you being spiritual. In fact, my prayer today is that we will recognize that the most spiritual act is to love and to have concern for each other in the body of Christ. It's not by how spiritual we seem. It's about our ability to love and care for each other. That goes to our ability to forgive, hatred towards each other, anger issues, letting it all go. That goes towards our pride, our selfishness, our own egos. Like, we got to die to those things, let those things go so that we can continue to care for each other as we should. In fact, John 15, 12 through 13, Jesus says this to his disciples. My command is this, love each other as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, to lay down one's life for one's friend. And that's what Jesus did for us on the cross. He was going to the cross. That's how we should live our lives. So on that note, if you haven't done it already, if you've got your Bible, open it up or open up your phone in the Bible app to 1 Corinthians chapter 11. We're going to talk about the second abuse Corinth was involved in, which is how they were abusing communion. So 1 Corinthians 11, verse 17, Paul says to the church, in the following directives, I have no praise for you, for your meetings do more harm than good. In the first place, I hear that when you come together as a church, there are divisions among you, and to some extent, I believe it. I mean, we've been dealing with division issues in the church, right? Verse 19, no doubt there have to be differences among you to show which of you have God's approval, which, kind of being a little sarcastic because in Christ we're all equal, right? Verse 20, so then, when you come together, it is not the Lord's supper you eat. For when you are eating, some of you go ahead with your own private suppers. As a result, one person remains hungry and another gets drunk. Don't you have homes to eat and drink in? Or do you despise the church of God by humiliating those who have nothing? What shall I say to you? Shall I praise you? Certainly not in this matter. For I received from the Lord what I had also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he gave thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance for me." In the same way, after the supper, he took the cup, saying, This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread or drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. So then, whenever you eat the bread or drink the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner, will be guilty of sinning against the body and the blood of the Lord. Everyone ought to examine themselves before they eat of the bread and drink from the cup. For those who eat and drink without discerning the body of Christ eat and drink judgment on themselves. This is why many, not all, I want to make sure we hear that. This is why many among you are weak and sick, and a number of you have fallen asleep. And there's debate on that word. Is that just kind of bedridden, or is that some have died? But if you were more discerning with regard to ourselves, we would not come under such judgment. Nevertheless, when we are judged in this way by the Lord, we are being disciplined so that we will not be finally condemned with the world. So then, my brothers and sisters, when you gather to eat, you should all eat together. Anyone who is hungry should eat something at home, so that when you meet together, it may not result in judgment. When I come, I'll give you further instructions or directions. So I want to give a little historical context about this idea of a love feast. So a love feast was the earliest Christian practice. It's documented in the Bible. That's kind of what this is. They had some real issues with it. But it's also just by Christian historians throughout the centuries talked about. In fact, in Jude verse 11, because there's only one chapter in Jude. So Jude verse, not 11, verse 12, it's actually mentioned. It says, these people are blemishes at your love feast. So a love feast, what it was, is the church would come together pretty often, and they would come together more than once a week. Well, oftentimes they're coming together every day, and they would often have communion every single time they gather together. But sometimes, maybe two or three times out of the week, they have a love feast. So what it is everyone brings food. It's a potluck. That's what it is. They have a giant potluck. They gather together. They have communion together, as they always do. And then they fellowship and eat food and just all those wonderful things. And just kind of connecting with each other as the body of Christ. And his Christian historian Tertullian even says this about love feasts. He says, they were often used to care for the poorer members of the church. So what I want to speak to is this phrase, there are divisions among you. Really what this means is there's two types of people in Corinth in the church. You've got the free people and then the slaves. You have the wealthy and the poor. And there may be some in the middle, but it's pretty clear that's kind of how it is. And so what's happening is the wealthy Corinthians think of themselves as that they're better than the poor members of the church. And so they make a plan like, hey, let's get together a little sooner. Let's have the love feast. Let's start it sooner. Let's exclude these people. We don't want them to be a part of this. So these wealthier members of the church would gather together. They would take communion together, excluding other people. And then they would have this love feast together. That's horrible. Communion was supposed to bring unity to the body of Christ, and now it's being used to bring division to the body of Christ. It's like telling your brothers and sisters, you're not good enough for this, stay over there, and once we're done doing it, you can come on in. And he goes on and says, I mean, look at this in verse 22, or do you despise the church of God by humiliating those who have nothing? How many of you would want to go to this church? Anybody? How many, like, if you were a poor person in this church, how many of you would go back to this church? Sadly, there's no other church. That's the only one there is. No one. No, like, this isn't cool. This isn't what God wants. We're humiliating. The wealthy people are basically saying, because you're poor, because of all those things, we're going to exclude you. You're not going to be a part. And then these wealthy people get fat and happy, eating all the food, doing all these things. At the same point, they're shaming their brothers and sisters. Almost could you see the scenario of a family, a poorer family. It's been two or three days since their day and a half since their last meal, and the love feast is going on that night. And they arrive, and they bring their kids, and they realize that it's all gone. How disheartening that would be. This is totally anti-Jesus, and it's an abuse of the spiritual meal, the holy sacrament of communion that Jesus called us to obey. So Paul goes on and takes a moment to explain communion. Communion, this is my body. It was a moment, and it is a moment for us to remember Jesus, to remember that Jesus is sinless, yet he went to the cross for you and me. That Jesus, in his perfection, in his divinity, humbled himself to nothing as a criminal. And he was pierced, and his blood was spilt, and his blood covers over all our sin. It doesn't cover over the rich more than it covers over the poor. It covers over everyone's sins equally. It covers over man and woman. It covers over black and white, Hispanic and Asian. It doesn't matter. In Christ, we are all one. We are a unified body in Christ. Salvation, this moment of remembering Christ's salvation for us and what he's done, shouldn't bring division like it is doing. It should bring unity. Because we have a reason to gather together. We have a common bond, and it's Jesus. That's why we're all in this room together, right? We're all different people from different walks of life and different everything, but yet we're one in Jesus. And so then Paul goes on to say, talking about this unworthy manner, really what this is, if you keep persisting in this sin of disunity, and specifically pride, and saying that you're better than, and putting them down, and keep thinking that you're good about, like you can keep taking communion and there's no issues, you got something else coming to you, buddy. So don't persist in this unworthy manner, because he's not just saying it's unworthy, he's saying don't persist in this unworthy manner because you are guilty of sinning
against the body and the blood of Jesus. You're not just guilty of sin in general. You didn't just sin against your brother and sister in Christ, which we did, or Corinth did. You're also now sinning against Jesus himself, using the spiritual things that he's given us to bring division rather than unity. It's kind of a sick thing when you think about it. Use the things that were meant for good for evil. And Paul goes on to explain, you need to examine yourself before you eat and drink the bread. And of course, you can expand this to all kinds of sins, but it's really talking about the sin of disunity, of pride, of selfishness, of excluding one another. It's a very relational thing that Paul is dealing with here. You need to examine your own life. Examine the bitterness in your heart. Examine your superiority. Examine your own pride, your selfishness, your unforgiveness. Examine your life. Because if you don't discern your life, if you don't discern there's wrong or there's sin or there's something in your life, this may be why some of you are sick. It didn't say this is why all of you are sick, so it's not the shoe fits for everything here. We don't want to get weird and say, well, this is always the reason why. No, it may be the reason why. Maybe because there's pride and there's unresolved issues and there's a lack of reconciliation and that there's unforgiveness, and that's the reason why you're sick. And then he goes on, and we're not sure if it's dead or bedridden, but it's clear he's saying, and that's why some of you are severely sick. It's because you are bringing yourself into God's judgment. But it's very good to know, because in 32, nevertheless, when we are judged in this way, really we're being disciplined. As Christians, as followers of Jesus, this isn't a judgment that kicks us out of the kingdom of God or removes us from salvation, but this is a judgment so that we can be disciplined and deal with the sin in our own lives. Amen. Get it out, reconcile, make things right, and then come back together as we should, honoring God together as a unified body. But, Paul says, if you persist in this behavior, you will experience the ultimate judgment of God. You will experience what Jesus went through on the cross, and you'll be separated from him. But no, I don't want that. I'll let Jesus take it for me. I'm going to follow Jesus. Follow him daily. We want to build our lives around the unity of Christ and on Jesus, and dying to our own selfishness, dying to our own pride, dying to our own issues, so that we can be a unified church. And then lastly, he says, so how to resolve this issue? He says, when you gather together for the love feast, do it all together. He didn't say do some of it together. He said do it all together. Like there's no, like you are unified in Jesus. Be together. And then he says, if you're hungry, just eat at home. Eat an extra candy bar, whatever you got to do. Get your Clif Bar out. Do whatever you need to do. But when you come together, it's not just about you being hungry. It's about everyone in the room. So I'd like to ask you this question before we move on. Are you unified with your local church? Are there people in this room, though, maybe, that you're not as unified with? Not just because you don't know them, but because there's tension. There's some hard feelings. There's some selfish and prideful tendencies that want to come up, and we don't really want to reconcile for whatever reason. And I really want to challenge you. You got to lay it down. Christ calls us, we got to die to ourselves. It's not about me anymore. It's about Christ and each other. We can act like we're the most spiritual people in the room, but if we're not really connected to our brothers and sisters in Christ, we're not really all that spiritual. But then I also want to flip it the other way. Maybe you've been the one that's been hurt, like the poorer members of the church. You know, this passage came to my mind, 1 Peter 4:8, let love cover a multitude of sins. And really kind of saying, you know what, I'm not going to allow bitterness to fester. I'm not going to allow, what they're doing isn't right, and I have every right to be angry at them and have unforgiveness, but actually, no, we don't, because Christ forgave us. And so we got to let go of our own selfishness, our own unforgiveness, and that's not easy. Can I get a witness to that? That's not an easy thing to do, but as Christians, that is one of the most deeply spiritual things that we can do. Yes. Learning to walk in that. That's hard. Yep. So I want to encourage you, church, if you've been wronged, make today a day where you say, you know what? I'm going to learn how to let it go. Yes. But you may have to pray about it every day. In fact, this scripture comes out of realizing that there's been someone in my life recently that's wronged me, and I'm hurt. But the Lord brought it back to my mind. Let love cover a multitude of sins. You actually love that person. That's why you're hurt. Right? Isn't that oftentimes why we're hurt? And so move on from it. And if you have an opportunity to talk about it, get it all out, do whatever you need to do. But it doesn't necessarily matter. Lord, just you do what you need to do in me. Point those things out. Let me die to those things so that I can walk in unity with my brothers and sisters in Christ. So let's kind of now move from there and go on to our final and third abuse, which is the abuse of speaking in tongues. So if you're here and you're like, what in the world is speaking in tongues? I'm going to try to really explain that quickly. One of the first places, it's not the only place, it is sometimes in the Old Testament, but the first place in the New Testament is in Acts chapter 2. Where the church is filled with the power of the Holy Spirit, and one of the evidences of that power is they're speaking in different languages. That's what tongues actually means. They're speaking in different languages, and then as they've been filled, they go out into the streets, and they're speaking these languages that other people on the street know. But the people who are speaking the languages don't know the languages. They've just been given the language by the Spirit. And so to kind of explain this, the act of speaking in tongues is the act of speaking a language one did not acquire by natural means. It's by the infilling of the Holy Spirit. This often related to either divine revelation or worship. The language may or may not be intelligible by other humans. And in Acts chapter 2, it was intelligible. In other moments, the scripture talks about just a language. It's almost like when you're alone, you're just with God. It's almost like an angelic or a heavenly language, and it's just God is strengthening you, and you don't know what else to say. You're just kind of with God and in that kind of way. And so we have speaking in tongues, but here's the problem that's going on in the church of Corinth. The church of Corinth has got this weird idea that the most important gift that the Spirit gives the church is speaking in tongues. Why? Because of spiritual superiority. Because and then we see in chapter 14, their services were disorder because you had people all over the place speaking in tongues at random moments. They're probably competing who can sound the most angelic, who can be the best, and they're kind of getting frenzy and crazy, and it's all working up into this weird, self-absorbed, very selfish, me-centric, look at me, I'm spiritual, look at all this, and it's not even about Jesus anymore. It's not about the brothers and sisters in the church. It's about the person. Would anyone here like to go to that church? I didn't think so. I don't want to go there. And so Paul, in chapter 12, has to take a step back, and he's creating an argument. He's creating context. He's saying, let me give you the context for what it means to be people of the Spirit. And let me talk about the gifts of the Spirit, what it means to serve one another. And as we make context, we'll bring the gifts or the speaking in tongues that's way out of context back into its proper place. So 12 and 13, he's given that context, and then in chapter 14, he's really trying to bring correction to the disordered nature of the church service and how they're kind of abusing speaking in tongues really for themselves. So I wanted to show you in 1 Corinthians chapter 14 four different scriptures. We'll deal with that more next week just to show you to get a bigger idea of the problem. Verse 4, Paul says, anyone who speaks in a tongue edifies themselves, but the one who prophesies edifies the church. And then he says in verse 9, unless you speak intelligible words with your tongue, how will anyone know what you are saying? You'll just be speaking into the air. Since you are eager for the gifts of the Spirit, try to excel in those that build up the church. Not just build up the self, but build up everyone. Verse 18 through 20, I thank God that I speak in tongues more than all of you. So Paul here is saying, tongues is a wonderful thing, and I believe it is for everyone. But in the church, I would rather speak 5 intelligible words to instruct others than 10,000 words in a tongue. Brothers and sisters, stop thinking like children. That's a hard, harsh statement, isn't it? Stop thinking like children. In regard to evil, be infants, but in your thinking, be adults. Grow up a little bit. It's not all about you. Don't you get it? Amen. So before we get into this, can I tell you a quick story? I remember Grayson and I, my cousin. We're good friends. We're close in age, 1.5 years apart. So who knows? We are between 7 and 9 probably. And so Pastor Lee, my grandpa, founding pastor of this church, and his dad, my uncle, Uncle Monty, was a pastor on this church. And we went with the family. We went to general councils in Washington, D.C. And Grayson and I, in the evening services, would go to the kids' services and just have fun, whatever. And one night, they talked about being filled with the Spirit. And, you know, we've heard that most of our lives, being filled with the Spirit, receiving power, which is real. Like, these are things that we want as followers of Christ. But, and we were both like, yeah, we want it. And we know the evidence of that is speaking in tongues. And so we kind of go up to the front and we're praying. And then before you know it, there's kind of like a holy huddle, like a football huddle around you. And we're praying and we're sweating. And some of the leaders and teenagers are praying over us. And we're there for at least, it feels like an hour, but it's not. It's probably 15 minutes, 20 minutes, whatever it is. And then neither one of us speak in tongues. That was that. Well, Grayson and I have both talked about that experience about 12 years later. This is where it gets good. And we have both looked back and said, we both realized every now and then we would look up at each other to find out, is he speaking in tongues yet? No. And then we would keep praying and kind of like, I want to speak in tongues first. And then we'd look, no, okay, we're good. I got an opportunity to beat him. I got an opportunity. And it gets rid of, like, we weren't really interested in speaking in tongues. We were interested in speaking in tongues before him. That's what it was all about. It's like, I just want to beat him to it, and I want to go tell my grandpa, look, grandpa, I can speak in tongues, and he can't. Yeah. And you know what I mean? It had nothing to do with Jesus. And it should have everything to do with Jesus. And it had everything to do with our competition to be better than each other, more spiritual. And that's at the heart of what I'm talking about here. We don't want to use the gifts of the Spirit are not to just make us more spiritual. They have a greater purpose than that, which we'll get into. So, chapter 12, verse 1. Now about the gifts of the Spirit, brothers and sisters, I do not want you to be uninformed. You know that when you were pagans, somehow or another, you were influenced and led astray to mute idols. I want you to know that no one who is speaking by the Spirit of God says, Jesus be cursed. And no one can say Jesus is Lord except by the Spirit. So I want to stop right here. So he's creating context. We've got to remember that. He's building a framework where the gift of speaking in tongues kind of comes into focus. What Paul is really communicating here is you want to pay attention to the content of the message, not the flashiness of the message. Not the fluff of the message. If someone seems spiritual, but their content doesn't point to Jesus, red flags go up immediately. If someone, they may sound the part, they may talk the part, but if they're not the part, don't listen to them. If you got a book that really doesn't point back to Jesus and it's really fluffy and it has no like anything, just get rid of the book. Don't read it. It's probably not worth your time reading. If you're listening to someone on YouTube who is just super fluffy and almost sometimes prophecy and the prophetic is a real deal, I'm not trying to knock that, but sometimes on YouTube you'll have these prophets and it's just a bunch of garbage. And they're just fluffing everything up. They're not really pointing to Jesus. They're kind of pointing to themselves. And then they say at the end, make sure to subscribe and like and help me out over here and take care of my finances. You know what I mean? And they're just kind of more about themselves and manipulating this gift for their own means. And I know we all kind of have this tendency to say it another way. There's people that just seem really spiritual to us because they say the words. They just know how to hold themselves in a certain way. And it's like, I just want to be like them. No, you don't want to be like them. You want to be like Jesus. That's the aim. We want to be like Jesus. And we got to be very careful about that. Very discerning and say, I'm not going to allow spirituality. I'm not going to allow fluffy, or I'm not going to allow the Christianese to deter me from the content of the message. And if the content points to Jesus, okay. If the content points to the messenger, not okay. So keep those things in the back of your mind. And to give you a quick analogy, yesterday Hannah and I went to a restaurant, fairly new restaurant, and we were very, very disappointed. And have you ever, you get on Instagram and it's like, oh, the marketing is on point. It's probably going to be a great restaurant. The food looks delicious. And so we go to this place and it was a total letdown. The coffee was not good. Something happened to the milk and it almost threw up. It was bad. The food was and it was just like, oh, I'm sorry, guys. I don't know how you're going to stay open for 6 months type place. And that's harsh. I'm not going to tell you the name. I'm not going to be that guy. Find out for yourself. But, and it's this, it's like they had the fluff, but they had no substance. That's what I'm talking about. You want the substance, not the fluff, as a follower of Jesus. And so let's continue reading on and kind of as Paul is building out this context here. Verse 4, there are different kinds of gifts, but the same Spirit distributes them. There are different kinds of service, but the same Lord. There are different kinds of working, but in all of them and in everyone, it is the same God at work. So what's Paul saying? He's saying, well, is there one Spirit, one God, one church, but there's different gifts that the Spirit wants to give to each one of us. Keep in mind, all Corinth wants, or the people of Corinth, is speaking in tongues. They're interested in one thing, not the diversity of gifts that the Spirit wants to give to the church. And then it goes on, and Paul kind of gives a list, not to be informative, but to give context. He says in verse 7, now to each one the manifestation of the Spirit is given for the common good. That's a big deal. It's not the Spirit. I'm not given a gift in the Spirit for myself. It's for us. Amen. It's for the church. Every gift that we have been given by the Holy Spirit, and it could be the ones mentioned here, this is not intended to be a complete list. It could be hospitality. It could be generosity. It could be all kinds of different things. God gives us those things for the common good. It goes on and says, to one there is given through the Spirit a message of wisdom, a message of knowledge, to another faith by the same Spirit, gifts of healing by that one Spirit, another miraculous power, prophecy, a distinguishing between the spirits, which is discernment, to another speaking in different kinds of tongues or languages, and still to another the interpretation of languages or tongues. All these are the work of one and the same Spirit, and he distributes them to each one just as he determines. Well, Paul is saying, hey, there's unity, but in the unity, there's a plethora and a diversity of gifts. You're not more spiritual or less spiritual if you have a particular gift. No, that's not the indicator of our spirituality. Christ and our faithfulness to each other and how we serve, those are greater indicators. So whatever Christ wants to give you, however he wants to take care of you with the gifts of the Spirit, run with it. Wow. Go with what he gives you. Use it to the best of his ability because God gave it for the common good. Anyways, verse 12, just as a body, though one, has many parts. So he creates an analogy here. But all its many parts form one body. So it is with Christ. We were all baptized by one Spirit so as to form one body, whether Jews or Gentiles, slave or free, and we were all given by the one Spirit to drink. Even so, the body is not made up of one part, but of many parts. So again, creating this, we're unified. A body's unified, but it's different. There's diversity. And so I'm not going to read 15 through 20. I'm just going to tell you an illustration that kind of drives the point home as well. But as football season is coming up, how many of you would think it'd be really smart to field a team with 11 offensive linemen. You got your whole team, you got one position, and it's made up of 11 guys that are between like 6'6 and 6'10, between 350 to 400 pounds. They look like a formative team, right? They look powerful and maybe a little fluffy at times. But, are they going to win many games? Do they have a chance of winning zero games? Absolutely. Because they don't have wide receivers. They don't have a quarterback. They don't have a running back. They don't have a fullback. They don't have tight ends. They didn't even diversify. It's 11 sinners. That's all it is. They don't have a chance. It's the same in the body of Christ. If we want to succeed as the body of Christ, the diversity of the Spirit is a wonderful thing in of our lives and is necessary for the health of the church. We're not looking to see, again, remember this context. It's not about one thing. We're bringing it all into context. This is what it means to be people of the Spirit. And then Paul drives this home. This next use of the metaphor, the body metaphor, this is the most important part of this passage. It says in verse 21, the eye cannot say to the hand, I don't need you. And the hand and the head cannot say to the feet, I don't need you. On the contrary, those parts of the body that seem to be weaker and indispensable, and the parts that we think are less honorable, we treat with special honor. And the parts that are unpresentable are treated with special modesty, while our presentable parts don't need any special treatment. But God has to put the body together, giving greater honor to the parts that lacked it, so that there should be no division in the body, but that its parts should have equal concern for each other. If one part suffers, every part suffers with it. If one part is honored, every part rejoices with it. See, this passage is communicating, as the church, we should have love and concern for one another. We should be thinking about each other's well-being. It's not about the gifts of the Spirit. It's in God wants to give us those things. We need those things to do the ministry. But it's about each other. Ultimately, first and foremost, it's about Jesus and how we point. We're all pointing to Jesus. But then it's about how we take care of each other, our concern for one another, our love for one another. You know, it would be like saying those weaker and indispensable parts. It's kind of like your brain. If half your skull was showing, you would be a little concerned, wouldn't you? And you'd want to cover up your brain. Because if you don't have a brain, you don't have much of nothing. You got to keep it covered. Those unpresentable parts, our sexual organs, man, they are necessary for the human race to continue, aren't they? Without them, we're not here. They're really important and deserve proper treatment and honor. But they should also be clothed appropriately and for every situation. And so it is with each other. The poor, the wealthy, the struggling, the hurt, those with certain gifts of the Spirit and those with other gifts of the Spirit. We care for each other in the body of Christ. We minister to each other. We meet each other's needs. We're there for each other. And then it goes on to say, you know, if one part of your body suffered, the whole body suffers. You know, it really is annoying when you've got a sticker or whatever it may be in your hand, doesn't it? You can't stop thinking about the sticker or the thorn or the splinter. That's really the word I'm thinking of. You can't think about the splinter, stop thinking about it until you get rid of it. And then if you don't get rid of it, it just starts kind of getting a little red and it's more annoying or got something in your eye. You got to deal with it. So when your whole body suffers, or when your one part of your body suffers, the whole body suffers and has to deal with it and have concern for and take care of and minister to and watch out for. And when the whole body is celebratory, or when one part of the body, like say you learn something new, how to way to live life, or something that just kind of clicks for you, and your brain learns something new, and it changes the whole kind of posture of your life. changes the way you walk, changes the way you see things, changes the way you take care of all of it. Everything changes. That's how we live our lives, church. With love and concern for one another. So I want to ask you a question as we come to a conclusion. Are you concerned about being spiritual, or are you concerned about the body of Christ? Because the aim should always be for one another. Of course, we want to become more like Christ, but that doesn't mean we have to become more spiritual. Because like we said at the beginning, oftentimes the most spiritual people we know are the most down-to-earth, relational, loving people you've ever met. So would you stand with me as we kind of think through these things together and as we close it up? You know, these last number of weeks have really built upon each other. 4 weeks ago now, Nick Hester was with us and he talked about those gray zones. And then the next week, ultimately, we talked about seeking the good of each other. And ultimately, Christ. We're seeking the good of Christ in each other. It's not about me. Last week, we talked about having healthy and honoring relationships that seek the good of the other person. We're not here to shame them. Even though we have the freedom, we're not there to shame them. We're there to build each other up. And then this week, again, it's this clear understanding. It's about love and having concern for each other. How many of you would say, you know, Pastor Rob, well, before I even ask that question, I'm going to do something else. I want to read John 15, 12 through 13 again. Jesus said, "My command is this, love each other as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, to lay down one's life for one's friend." And that's what Jesus says when he says, die to yourself, pick up your cross and follow me. It's not about you anymore. It's a hard truth because we like life to be about us, don't we? Hey, maybe you're here today. You're not following Jesus, or maybe you've just kind of grown distant and you want to rededicate your life to Christ. I want you to know Jesus laid down his life for you and me. That's a big deal. He loved us so much. He does not want us to die in our sin. He does not want us to be eternally separated from him. No, Jesus gave his only life so that we could experience new life in Christ. And thank goodness Jesus isn't dead. He's alive. Because sin couldn't hold him down. And if sin can't hold him down, it can't hold me down when I choose to follow Jesus. And it can't hold you down when you decide to follow Jesus. And so if you're here today and you'd say, you know what, I'm ready to give my life to Jesus. I'm ready to lay down my sin so I can follow him. If that's you and you want to give your life to Christ for the first time, or maybe you just need to rededicate your life, would you just raise your hand? Is there anyone here? I see your hand back there. Yes, thank you for that. Is anyone else? I see that hand, yes. Can I have some of the prayer team come up here as I'm going? Anyone else? I want to make sure to give everyone an opportunity. Okay. Well, for those two gentlemen who raised their hand, maybe I can get some of the prayer team to go right over there. And Nick Pucallo, if you'll just go right back there, and they'll raise their hand. These guys, these prayer teams, they want to pray for you. They're right back there. Just keep walking back there. You'll see them. And maybe there's one other, Pastor Tim, if you can make your way over there. And we want to pray for those guys. And they're going to pray with them a prayer of salvation. They're going to tell them what it means to follow Jesus. But for everyone else in this room, man, by the way, if you did give your life, we're one of those guys. I just want to say I'm so proud of you guys. Excited for you. That's a big deal. It really is a big deal. But for everyone else in the room, if you'd say, you know what, Pastor Rob, I need to keep dying to my sin. Well, and let me make it more specific. I need to keep dying to my pride. My hand's up to that. Anyone there with me? We got to keep dying to our pride, keep dying to ourselves. And that's not easy, but that's the work of following Jesus. That is a deeply spiritual thing to do. Say, I'm not quite where I need to be, but guess what? It's okay. I'm forgiven. I'm going to keep following Jesus. So if you've raised your hand, well, before I pray, I want to do something, then we'll pray together. This is for everyone, but especially those who raise their hand. I want to challenge you to do something this week. I want you to be concerned for someone else in your life. Not yourself. Say no to yourself and say, I'm going to take care of someone else. And it's a no strings attached, no recognition needed, no thank you even needed. I don't need anything. I just want to take care of someone else, to be a blessing, to love them, to be concerned for them. And it could be someone in the church, be a family member, whatever it may be. And it could be as simple as listening and praying with them in that moment. It could be putting gas in someone's car. It could be picking up their kids from school because you're there and you know they're stressed and you could help them out in that way. It could be all kinds of things. But this week, I want to encourage you to find a way to be concerned for someone else and meet their need. How many of you will try to do that this week? Do it. I'm encourage you to do that. I'm going to do it with you. But if you raise your hand for any reason, if you will, just put your hands out in front of you just as a way of saying, Lord, here I am. I need your help. All my junk and all my problems. I want to pray for you. Lord, you know everyone that's here. You know who we are. You know our situations. You know our tendency maybe to be over-spiritual or to strive to look the part. But Lord, I don't want to look the part. And I don't want us to look the part. I want us to be the part. So help us today to die to our own pride. Help us to forgive where we need to forgive. Help us to let go where we need to let go. Help us to recognize love covers over a multitude of sins where it's just hard to not forget. Help us to deny ourselves, even in our own selfishness and our own pride, to say, Lord, it's not about me. Help me to die to this. I'm here for others. I'm here for the church. I'm here for my coworkers. I'm here for my family. And Lord, more than anything, we can never be who you've called us to be unless we really make time to be with you. Because we want to be like you, Jesus. So this week, I pray that you help each one of us make time for you. Make time to pray. Make time to listen to you. Make time to be reading the Bible a little bit and to make time to serve those in our lives that need our help. Lord, I pray your blessings. I pray your hand upon everyone's life. I pray you encourage them this week. Watch over them. And while we're separated, until we see each other again on Wednesday or next Sunday. And in Jesus' wonderful name, amen. God bless you, church. We'll see you next week. You raise your hand after they're done talking. We'd love to talk to you myself. Shake a hand, whatever it may be. Need any prayer, we're down here to pray with you too. God bless.